puddles. Colorado College wins it 4-3. We'll effort to show you highlights to this game later. Again, a fantastic finish in double overtime. Almost went to three overtime. We're going to get you out to the top of the hour, to the site, hopefully, for some hockey.
Welcome live to the Riverfront Coliseum in Cincinnati, Ohio. You're looking at the ice surface, and that has been the story of the day in this building. There was an accident before game one of the semifinals of the NCAA Division I ice hockey tournament that held up the start of that game a half hour, having to do with the refrigerant coil. And it was ruptured and fluid leaked all over the place. They got it patched up well enough to play game one of this tournament this afternoon between Vermont and Colorado College. They worked on it feverishly after that double overtime game concluded. They have just finished working on it, but now the problem is with this ice service, they have to put the refrigerator coils, give enough time to refreeze the service. They can't play Michigan and Boston University right at this time as we speak. I'm Tom Meese. Bob Norton will join me when they finally get this game underway. There was some hockey played and plenty of it earlier in the day in this building, albeit on less than perfect ice, and it was decided nine minutes, 31 seconds into the second overtime on a weird goal that's credited to Colorado College's Chad Remickle. Jay McNeil was given the assist at 9:31 of the second overtime. Vermont protested, saying that the goal should have been disallowed, but it was allowed. And right after that game, they brought out the work crews. The goal crease where the winning goal in the first game was scored, that's the root of the problem. They were tapping in there to set the goal post down before the first game. They tapped into a plastic pipe that ruptured, and the ice surface has never been the same. Now, Boston University in the red and white is getting set to play the maize and blue of Michigan in what should be a great, great college hockey game. And when they get this thing started, we'll have it for you on ESPN2. They're waiting for the temperature of the ice to be such that they can play quality college hockey. We'll be back with more from Cincinnati in a moment. Again, back here live in Cincinnati, and again, summarizing for you, we have problems with the ice surface at the Riverfront Coliseum. They plagued us during the first game, forced that game to start a half hour late. They got that game in, double overtime thriller. Colorado College won the game. They'll be in the national title game Saturday afternoon. We're going to wait here as long as we can to try and get this one in tonight. And stay tuned to ESPN2 for further updates. Until then, let's join Paul Romanuk and the NHL. Be a...
This game, it's the little things that make the difference.
I'd like to think of myself as a guy that enjoys the game, a guy that enjoys the young guys, a guy that enjoys passing things on and helping the young guys, and that's, to me, what the game is all about.
The NHLPA presents Be a Player, the hockey show. Brought to you by EA Sports. If it's in the game, it's in the game. And by Upper Deck. You don't just watch the game, you play it.
Welcome to Be a Player, the hockey show. I'm your host, Paul Romanuk, coming to you this week from London, England. Actually, it could be with all this fog. In fact, we are in Detroit, where the weather's great if you're a Duck, and it's even better if you're a hockey fan, because you're looking forward to the Detroit Red Wings playoff march. The fans in this city have been waiting for years for the Red Wings to take that run and win the Stanley Cup. This could well be the year. You look at the lineup they have, man, it's a talented one. And a big part of that lineup is defenseman Paul Coffey. Paul is the focus of our attention this week. We caught up with Paul last summer at his cottage in Muskoka, Ontario, in Canada. He was very relaxed. We had a great time. The weather was a lot nicer. You really enjoyed that chat. Also coming up, the usual mixed bag of stuff. Wayne Gretzky, along with great hockey moments. The great moment this week was indeed one of the great moments in the history of Canadian international hockey. The winning goal in the 1987 Canada Cup. Canada against Russia. Gretzky to Lemieux. He shoots. He scores. You remember that. It was a heck of a goal. If you don't, you'll want to hear Wayne talk about it. Also coming your way, John Davidson with Hockey Heroes. The hero this week, number four, Bobby Orr.
If ever a player has been credited with setting the standard for his position, it was number four, Bobby Orr.
stellar career with the Boston Bruins, and JD, we'll talk about Bobby a little bit later on in the show. But we start things off with, as usual, Hang On, it's the Billboard Hit Parade. Time. You know the drill. Go to your computer, log on to the NHLPA website. NHLPA.com is the address. I'm going to ask you the question. Be the first person onto the website with the correct answer before we give it later on in the show, and you will receive a genuine hockey video game courtesy of EA Sports. If you're not the first person, don't worry about it. We'll take all the other correct answers given before we give you the answer later in the show. We will take from that lot the name of one lucky person. Said person will receive an NHLPA hockey jersey with an autograph. Here is this week's question. Name the first U.S.-born player to accumulate 1,000 career points in the NHL. The first U.S.-born player, 1,000 career points in the NHL. Good luck.
Send your answer via the internet to the NHLPA's website at www.nhlpa.com.
Hey everybody, for those of you expecting to tune into the Deuce to see Boston University and Michigan semifinal hockey action, well, we'd like nothing better than to show it to you, except there's a problem with the ice at Cincinnati's Riverfront Stadium. Water on the ice right there, as you can see, they're attending to it. There's a problem with the refrigeration system. A coil popped and flooded the ice. It was the same problem that delayed the Colorado College-Vermont game a half hour. Stay tuned. We're going to try and keep you updated. More news when we have it.
Well, we all know how the Detroit Red Wings' quest for a Stanley Cup ended last year. It ended very quickly in the final at the hands of the New Jersey Devils. But boy, you look at the team this year, you look at the talent, the experience in the lineup, the coach, Scotty Bowman, and you go, here's a team that could win it all. Again, I'm sure they're going to take another big run at it. If they do win the Stanley Cup, Paul Coffey will be a big part of that effort, and Paul Coffey would become a piece of NHL trivia, so to speak. Paul would be only the seventh player in the history of the NHL to win the Stanley Cup with three different teams. Of course, Stanley Cups in Edmonton, Pittsburgh, and he would win one with the Detroit Red Wings. When you talk to Paul, he's a very focused and intense individual. He comes to the rink to do a job every time. That's what's made him as great as he is. But when you catch up with him away from the hockey environment, away from the arena, away from the regular season and the playoffs and all that stuff, you see a very relaxed Paul Coffey. Another side of him. That's the side that we saw at his cottage last summer.
Takes over, takes the shot, he scores!
person at this point with what you've done, or is there always still sort of that next peak you want to climb?
Definitely the next peak. I think anytime you get content doing what you're doing, whether it's hockey or anything in life, I mean, you're done. I think hockey for me and sports in general is a very motivating thing, and if I'm not motivated, I'm not going to be any good out there.
Gets a pick for Primo Coffee. Somebody scores!
I hear a lot of athletes talk about that. They can put it different ways, but they talk about that fire that burns within that acts as a bit of motivation. Is it fair to say that it's you still have the fire, but maybe at this stage it's a little tougher to stoke that fire than it used to be?
Yeah, keep it going consistently for a long period of time. I think the motivation is still there, the excitement is still there. I mean, I love going to the rink. I think if you have a team that has some older, experienced guys on the team, and then you have some younger guys, like we've got McCarty, LaPointe, Greg Johnson, Tim Taylor, a lot of young guys with a lot of fire, I mean, that helps me. That makes me appreciate the game a lot more and want to keep up with them.
And you have to play the role of the elder statesman, so to speak, and do you kind of chuckle when you think of that at all?
Yeah, it's kind of funny. I don't consider myself a preacher in the dressing room or anything like that. I like to think I speak when something needs to be said, so to speak. But, you know, I'm all for guys going out and having a good time and stuff like that. But I think that's important to a hockey team. But every now and then you got to slow guys down a little bit, because I think when I broke into the league, conditioning was a big part of the game, but nowhere near like it is right now. It's a 12-month, a year job.
I don't know what your memory's like for detail, but if you could, as best you can, what was it like, the dying moments of the game when you won your first Stanley Cup? Where were you? What was going on? Who were you talking to?
It was kind of a wild third period. We were up 4-0. The Islanders come out with two quick goals. It was 4-2. There was like 18 minutes to go in the third period, so we're all, I guess I was 21 or 22 around the bench. We're just, you know, squeezing our sticks, nervous wreck. And it so happened, Pat Flatley ran over Andy Moog, playing his grand shirt, and took a penalty. So it took all the Islanders' momentum away. We managed to get through the period. Dave Lumley scored a goal to make it 5-2, and it was like, just sitting there relieved. I think the first thing I did was look in the stands, saw where my mother and father were. And, you know, you're looking now, looking for friends, and seeing how everybody's reacting. And all of a sudden, the thing ticks down, you're just going crazy. I remember vividly, Mark Messier, we were at one end of the rink, on top of Andy Moog. Mark went right to the other end of the rink, had his gloves and stick, throwing him in the crowd with his family and everybody sitting there. So just real exciting.
I've known Paul since I was 14 years old. We played minor hockey together. And the thing that people don't know about Paul Coffey is that he might be one of the hardest working players I've ever played with. He's dedicated and committed to winning. I think he's proven that every team he's played for, he's got either won a championship or got close to winning a championship. So, no question, I consider him to be one of the greatest players ever played a game.
Leaning over the seat.
Score by Coffey on the drive from the point.
What's the lowest you've ever felt during your hockey career? Was it leaving Edmonton?
No, that was kind of a relief, you know, not trying to sound smart about it, but it was a bit of a relief. I got into a situation right there where I wasn't happy with a lot of things. I've always been one to voice my opinion. Sometimes probably shouldn't, but I live with it, pay the consequences, and it wasn't that bad. What stands out, San Jose last year hurt big time, losing them in the playoffs. We lost to L.A. in 1982. I was with the Oilers in the playoffs, but at that time we were young kids. We were 20, 21 years old. We should have won. I think just overall the disappointment of losing, it's probably the lowest point.
We've had a lot of fun when he was here in Pittsburgh, and it was a great change for me when he came to Pittsburgh to be able to play with a great defenseman like Paul Coffey. He's, as you all know, a great skater and he's a great passer, and to be able to get in between those defensemen and get the puck every time was a lot of fun. He's one of the best defensemen that ever played the game. And, I feel very fortunate to that I had a chance to play with Paul.
And here comes Coffey in there with a shot. Rebound, score!
I mean, what's it like to win a big individual award, you know, like the Norris Trophy? I mean, there's not that, I guess, time ticking down and all of a sudden you've won. How did you react the first time you won that? How'd you find out?
I was more excited this time than I was the first two times. I think my first Norris, I had, 125 or 130 points or something, and I think it was plus 50 or 60. And the second year was the same thing, so it was I didn't know for sure, but it was maybe a given. This year, I mean, there's so many great players out there. I mean, Ray Bourque refuses to go away. Plays great every year. Shelley plays great every year. Then you got Leach, and you got some young guys coming up. So this year, I was the most excited.
Across for Coffey. Coffey, a pass, and let's go!
What a goal. There's a play by a heady hockey player, Paul Coffey.
Tell me about being a family man.
Love it. If I had known it was going to be this exciting, I would have done it a long time ago. It's quite a feeling. Anybody that has kids will tell you that. It's probably the only real, to me, wonder left in the world. Just having a baby daughter, it's a great feeling. Puts everything into perspective and makes you very proud.
I just want to ask you about your cottage. Tell me a bit about the place. When did you get it? What do you love about it?
I love everything about it. I bought it in 1989, did a bunch of work to it, got it the way I like it. And to me, this is the best place in the world. I think you work hard for 8 or 9 months, pressure and a whole bit of playing hockey. I think anybody that's up there will tell you the same thing. There's no better life than lake life. And to me, it's a solitude. It's great. It charges my battery for the next season. I love it.
Place isn't full of hockey memorabilia. How come?
The wife. When I was single, I had a few pictures hanging there, but the wife doesn't want anything up there, which is rightfully so. It's a place where you get away from the game and just don't even think about hockey, which is great. A lot of people don't talk about it up here other than hot and driving me nuts every night, but no, it's great.
Coffey in there with a shot. Rebound. Scores.
If somebody just met you, what would they say Paul Coffey's defining characteristic is?
A lot of people probably think I'm laid back, think I'm quiet because I don't open myself up to a lot of people. But I think competitive, a guy that likes to show up and play hard every night, likes to win, is a proven winner. I've been fortunate throughout my career to win 4 Stanley Cups, but I'd like to think of myself as a guy that enjoys the game, a guy that enjoys the young guys, a guy that enjoys passing things on and helping the young guys, and that's, to me, what the game is all about.
This Be A Player profile has been brought to you by Duracell. You can't top the copper top.
Hope you're enjoying Be A Player, but what you're probably asking, Michigan and Boston University, will they be a playing anytime soon? Well, they're still attending to the ice, Cincinnati's Riverfront Center. Problem with the refrigeration system, like we told you, there's water on the ice, they're waiting for it to freeze. Hopefully this will be fixed so we can get some hockey. Up until then, enjoy the rest of Be A Player. Stay tuned.
Great Hockey Moments with Wayne Gretzky is brought to you by Upper Deck. You don't just watch the game, you play it.
1987 was a time of glasnost, a warming of relations between the USSR and the rest of the world. On the ice, however, it was business as usual as Canada faced the powerful Soviet Union in the Canada Cup.
Moving into leading Canada the red face circle.
Many have called the medal round of that tournament the most dazzling continuous display of hockey ever. Going into Game 3 at Cops Coliseum in Hamilton, Canada and the USSR were knotted at a game apiece.
Well, a brilliant goal ties this game up with work into Gretzky. Gretzky cutting in, center to Lemieux. Got it wide, dropped behind the net. Up to Murphy. Murphy to Gretzky, hit the post.
This was one of the strongest Soviet teams ever assembled, with players like Makarov, Larionov, Fetisov, and Krutov leading the way.
All alone in front of the net, set up by Krutov, and an early...
With less than 2 minutes to go, and the score tied 5-5, I broke down the wing with Mario Lemieux trailing. A quick pass, Mario found the top shelf to record his 11th goal of the series, a nice 6-5 victory for Team Canada. Only a few years later, many of our Soviet opponents would be our teammates in the NHL, bringing with them a wealth of talent and adding to the list of great moments in hockey.
Join me next time on Be a Player for more great hockey moments. I'm Wayne Gretzky.
At the start of the season, the NHL's 500 goal club was an exclusive one. Only 19 players in the history of the league had scored 500 or more regular season goals. Only twice before have two players reached this milestone in the same year. Most recently in 1991-92 when Mike Gartner and Michel Goulet scored their 500th. This season, however, Mario Lemieux, Marc Messier, Steve Yzerman, and Dale Hawerchuk have each tally goal number 500.
And just scored his 500th NHL goal.
Within striking distance of 500 are Joe Mullen of the Bruins and Glenn Anderson, once again, a member of the Edmonton Oilers. Thanks to these great players, the 95-96 season is one for the record.
Well, still some problem with the ice in Cincinnati. No Michigan-Boston University as of now. Again, a problem with the refrigeration system in Cincinnati. There's more water on the ice than ice itself. We're going to go back to Be a Player and keep you updated as news warrants. Again, here's Be a Player.
It's time for John Davidson's Hockey Heroes, brought to you by Bauer and Cooper, the names wear.
If ever a player has been credited with setting the standard for his position, it was number four, Bobby Orr, who controlled games from the blue line like no defenseman before him. In 1967, the 18-year-old Orr stepped into the spotlight on a Boston team noted for toughness and stifling defense. The cornerstone of the rebuilding Bruins, he quickly became the dominant player in hockey. His end-to-end rushes electrified fans as he led Boston to two Stanley Cup victories. And for eight straight seasons, he held a lock on the Norris Trophy as the game's best defenseman. His skating and passing were the key to the record-setting Bruins scoring machine of the early 70s.
Second goal of the period to give Boston a commanding 3-0 lead.
Orr remains the only defenseman ever to win a scoring title, a feat he accomplished twice. When he retired in 1978, Orr held virtually every scoring record for defensemen with 270 goals and 645 assists. Bobby Orr was inducted into the Hall of Fame in 1979. Perhaps his grittiest performance came in 1976. On badly damaged knees, he skated for Canada in the first Canada Cup and was named the tournament's outstanding player. It was a fitting tribute for the man whose play set the stage for a new generation of offensive blue liners. For Hockey Heroes, I'm John Davidson.
This week's trivia question is, what NHL
who is the first? Be a Player trivia is brought to you by EA Sports. If it's in the game, it's in the game.
Jeopardy, isn't it?
Here's a good one, boys. Who is the first American-born player to amass 1,000 career NHL points?
That's one of yours, I think.
Neil Broughton?
Good try, good try.
And raw.
Wow, that's a good one. U.S. born. Would it be a Broughton?
No, it's a good guess, though.
God, I think you we should be asking this one, Bob, since you're a U.S. person now.
Well, I know the answer because I looked on the back of the card.
American-born player.
Oh, I guess Bobby Carpenter?
And, oh!
I think I got it.
I'll see how come I get the easy one.
I'm not positive if I have it correct, though.
Does he have a brother in the NHL?
I think, yeah. That's the guy I'm thinking about.
That's what I'm thinking about, too, but
and
it
could be.
It could be the guy who just won the Stanley Cup last year.
That's who I think it is.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Cam Broughton?
Yeah.
U.S. born. I believe he's in Boston.
Well, that would be Kevin Stevens.
Nope.
No, he isn't.
Is he playing now or is he retired?
The player that surpassed it or his brother?
The player that surpassed it.
He's still playing.
Joey Mullen.
Yeah!
I knew I'd get one of these.
That is the correct answer. Joey Mullen. Wow. First U.S.-born player to score 1,000 points.
Did Neil Broughton score? Did he have 1,000 points?
Maybe I don't know, but he was the first.
Okay.
I feel like a weatherman. Still. Problems with the ice in Cincinnati. Michigan and Boston University delayed. They're trying to get the ice to cool. We're going to let you know what's going on. Again, here's Be a Player. Enjoy.
And that is our show for this week, folks. Be sure to join us next time. A little bit of a contrast. We're going to mix it up. We go from covering an established NHL star, Paul Coffey, playing for an established NHL team with a lot of tradition, Detroit, one of the original six, to looking at a player who is still carving out an identity for himself in the league, as well as a team that is doing the same. Paul Kariya and the mighty Ducks of Anaheim will be our stop next time on Be a Player, the Hockey Show. Until then, I'm Paul Romanek. I'll talk to you later on.
Please contact us via the internet at NHLPA.com with your questions and comments about Be a Player, the Hockey Show. Be a Player, the Hockey Show has been brought to you by EA Sports. If it's in the game, it's in the game. And by Upper Deck. You don't just watch the game, you play it.
Welcome back to Smash Headquarters. I'm your ice expert, Rich Eisen. There is problems with the ice in Cincinnati's Riverfront Coliseum, delaying the beginning of the Michigan-Boston University game. Let's go out to our ice expert on the site, Tom Meese, to find out what the deal is with the surface. Tom.
Welcome back to Riverfront Coliseum in Cincinnati, Ohio. I feel like I'm conducting rainout theater on the opening day of Major League Baseball. I'm Tom Meese back here at the hockey rink, but it's really not a hockey rink yet. That's why we haven't started playing. The problem with the ice here at the Riverfront Coliseum started before the first game between Colorado College and Vermont this afternoon, and they got that game in, albeit in much less than would be championship ice conditions. They did get it in. Colorado College won in double overtime. The ice conditions are delaying our telecast of the second, the much-anticipated second game between Boston University and the University of Michigan. And joining us now is Jack Parker, Jr., the head coach of Boston University. And, Jack, it's got to be hard on both teams waiting, and it's got to be hard on you and Red Berenson trying to keep the lid on the emotions of these young men who want to get out here and play.
Well, I think they're happy they are going to get the chance to play tonight, though. They were kind of sitting around and hanging out with each other, actually, and I was sitting with Red, so it's not exactly a frenzied moment, but I think they'll get back geared up once they get out in the ice and get going to the warm-up.
What have you been told, Jack, as far as how long it will take to get this ice going and what kind of quality ice we're going to have when it finally gets, when they rule it set to play?
I think we'll find out after the warm-up. They'll make a decision after the warm-up whether it really is set. We're going to warm up at 9:05. And then we'll go out and get off the ice and see how it sets up after that. But right now they're thinking that, that they've saved the ice and that it'll be fine by the time we get out for the warm-up.
Well, that would be good because I don't think they want to get into a situation where they have to postpone tonight's second game altogether and have both you fine teams play tomorrow because the title game, yes, it's Saturday, but it's at 1 o'clock Saturday afternoon.
Yeah, one of the reasons why we went to the Thursday-Saturday format was so one team didn't have to play Friday and have the disadvantage of having to come right back and play within 24 hours. But I don't think we can be like Ernie Banks and play two on Saturday.
No, I don't think so. Not with a 1 o'clock starting time for television. Your team in Michigan, what kind of game? Let's get to hockey for a moment. What kind of game do you anticipate? You think it's going to be high scoring?
I hope it is, and I think they're a little bit more proficient at that type of game than we are right now. But I don't think it'll be a 2-1 game either. We're both pretty good offensively. We're both pretty solid on the D and in the goal. I think both teams are known for their offense, but don't get enough credit for their defensive ability. So, you know, I think if we're both playing the top of our game, it'll be a fairly tight checking game.
Well, Jack, they say that good things come to he who waits, so hopefully we'll all wait together. We'll have a good game and a great ice service. Thanks for taking time out to join us.
Okay, John, thank you.
Jack Parker, head coach of the Terriers of Boston University. That's the latest here from Cincinnati. They're telling us now that the puck drop will be on or about 9:30 p.m. Eastern time. We'll be back to update you and keep it here on the news for the hockey game.
Welcome back to the Deuce Studios. It's time for a sports smash once again. The beginning of the Boston University Michigan college hockey semifinal delayed due to problems with the ice. Now, the problems have been with the ice all afternoon. The first game of the day, Vermont and Colorado College, was delayed because of the ice problems, a problem with the refrigeration system. Too much water on the ice. They're trying to make the ice solid right now in time for the Michigan-Boston University game. We'll see if that happens. But first, let's show you the highlights to the Vermont-Colorado College game. A fantastic finish in this one. We can go out to the Cincinnati Riverfront Coliseum. This game was tied at 3, late in double overtime. Colorado College with the puck. Jay McNeil shoots off the crossbar, and there's Chad Remackle to poke it in. Vermont can't believe it. As Colorado College is ecstatic, Vermont won a ruling from the officials. And the reason is this, because Jay McNeil, as he shoots and the puck comes off the crossbar, watch his hand. It seems like he grabs it and shoves at it. Therefore, Remackle would be there in time to knock it off of goalie Tim Thomas's pad and into the goal. However, the goal would stand. Happened a little too quick for the referees perhaps to see that hand pass. And Colorado College is your winner. They win it 4-3, the second longest semifinal ever. 89 minutes, 31 seconds. The Tigers will take on the winner of the Michigan-BU game, which could be coming up. Hopefully it will. They're saying the game might start at 9:30. Well, time ran out for Rick Lee Thursday. The Vancouver Canucks coach was fired with just 6 games left in the regular season. Canucks GM Pat Quinn named himself as Lee's replacement. Lee replaced Quinn on the Vancouver bench in August of 1994. Lee's record is 2 seasons, 47-50-27. The Canucks have been lethargic at home, losing 18 in GM place this season. Vancouver's most recent home loss, a 6-2 defeat to Toronto, came 12 hours before Lee's firing. Problems abound in Vancouver. The Canucks have gone 2-8 over their last 10. And allowed 2 more goals again than they scored. You see right there, they've also seen their playoff position sink to 6th, tied with Calgary, 1 point ahead of Toronto. We're going to be back with more smash in a moment. Actually, no, we've got my mistake, Canadians and Bruins highlights. Mark Rickey coming in on the attack, and it's a save by Bill Ranford. The Canadians, however, will try again. This game scoreless with about 5 and change to go in the first. Saku Koivu skating, shoots and scores. It's 1-0 Montreal after period number 1. Bruins 8-1-1 in their last 10 games. It was Koivu's 18th on the season. Florida and Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh leading this game 2-0. Mario Lemieux. My goodness, his 64th goal coming off that 5-goal performance. He's got 9 points in his last 2 games. Mike Huff with the goal for Florida. Now, we're going to take a break. Getting ahead of myself there. We'll be back with more smash tennis, golf, coming your way. Don't go anywhere.
To describe a headache. You just want it gone. But now with Tylenol, 2 Advil work better on tough headache pain There is Excedrin, but that's aspirin and the ingredient Tylenol and caffeine. I don't want all that. I'll go with Advil.
Advil contains the number one doctor-prescribed pain reliever in its class.
Nothing is proven to work better or last longer than Advil.
And now, introducing new Advil gel caplets. One more advance for Advil. Advanced medicine for pain.
Enter the performance zone with Splitfire Performance V smart plug.
Get your passing gear, you're gone.
The difference in gas mileage has been fantastic.
Splitfire Performance V smart plugs mean better performance, more horsepower, and better mileage. So say the experts and the people who use them.
They're the best plugs I ever put in my car.
Enter the performance zone only with Splitfire Performance V's, guaranteed.
Now, don't ask me why, but Sharon wants to meet you. So once she gets here, just say hello, act normal, then we're out of here.
I can't believe my little Billy has a girlfriend.
Okay, first rule, my name is Bill, and I'm not little.
Bill?
You're not gonna wear that.
What?
What's with that hair?
What?
Why is he in a suit?
Oh,
why did I agree to this? Hi, Sharon, this is my family, let's go.
Hey, wait, we're just going to McDonald's. Maybe they'd like to come with us.
McDonald's? Yeah, that's okay with you, Bill.
Welcome back to The Smash. I'm Rich Eisen. Now to a little bit of tennis news. The Lipton Championship lost its top men's seed, Tomas Muster, earlier in the tournament, and that left the door wide open for Pete Sampras, an opportunity for Pistol Pete to regain the world's number one ranking. He took on Vince Spadia in the quarterfinal match today. First set, Sampras in the far court. Spadia hits a great shot down the line. However, Spadia didn't have many good moments after that. Sampras off the Spadia return. No chance. Smoked it. Sampras wins the first set 6-3. Second set, Sampras had Spadia all over the place. Here he has him going one way, goes the other. Sampras, 32 winners in this one. Then Spadia serving. Sampras in the foreground. Later, Sampras cruises into the semifinals. Higher final, 6-3, 6-4. If he goes on to win the tournament, he will regain the number one ranking. Pete faces the winner of the last quarterfinal, which features fourth seed Michael Chang against Goran Ivanišević. Chang is 22-3 on the year. Women's action. We go to beautiful Key Biscayne. First set, top seed Steffi Graf. Second serve, Lindsay Davenport. All over that. Tied at 2 in the first, then Graf comes alive. Off the cross court, it's a winner. 4-4 in the first, still in the first, Graf far court. Davenport hits it off the tape. Graf is there for the backhand volley winner. Wins the first set, 6-4 does Steffi. Second set, Davenport's backhand falls apart. Oh boy, unforced errors. She had 32 of them. Meanwhile, Graf cruising. Your match point comes at 103 miles an hour off the serve. Graf advances to the final, 6-4, 6-4. Either 6-seed Chanda Rubin or unseeded Karina Hapsidova gets the privilege of meeting Ms. Graf in the final, if that's a privilege. This is the only tournament outside of the majors that includes men and women. Now let's go to a sport we call golf, but the Scottish call golf without the L. It's not a major, but the field certainly makes it look like one. It's the Tournament Players' Championship, this year's warm-up to the Masters. To Sawgrass we go. Mark Pontevecchia from about 25 feet out for good. He sinks it. He finished at 5 under par on the 13th. Justin Leonard, 20-foot birdie. Oh, beautiful read. He goes to 4 under. He shares the lead at 7 under. Kenny Perry on 14. His second shot. Looks like trouble in the trees, but oh, what a gorgeous bounce. 6 feet from the cup. The type of day it was for Kenny. On 14th, Nick Faldo chipping from the rough. He gets it to drop. Goes to even par on 14. Phil Mickelson putting from 18 feet away. Smooth stroke for Phil. Oh, yeah. Oh, drops in there. Birdie, 6 of his first 8 holes, and there's your weather warning. Play was suspended due to lightning. Justin Leonard and Kenny Perry each carded a 765. They tied a course record for 9 holes. Each of them did. Perry shot a 30 on the front. Leonard on the back 9 did the same. Defending champ Lee Jansen finished at 2 under after a costly double bogey on 18. Ladies action. Dinah Shore in Rancho Mirage, California. And Amy Alcott's fourth shot on the par five. Par five ninth is what I meant to say. Stopped within inches. She finished 4-under. Annika Sorenstam's approach on 9.
And she never slices.
10 feet. Now for the par. Annika misses the par. She's got a putter. It's in the hole. She finished 5-under. She is tied with Tracy Curtick. Amy Alcott looking for her 4th Dinah Shore victory. We have more smash on the way. Again, look at that ice. Believe me, there's problems with it. We'll let you know if they're going to actually play this game. Stay with us. Come on back.
When you go fishing with a lawnmower, then why trim your lawn with fishing line? Forget it. Here comes the Weed Terminator. 3 awesome cutting blades that swing out and are held in position by centrifugal force. Weeds are defenseless against them, and trimming has never been easier. The entire unit installs quickly and easily to whiz through even the thickest grass and weeds. Turn your gas-powered trimmer into a powerful Weed Terminator. Broken trimmer line? Terminated. Wasted time? Terminated. Expensive replacement spools? Terminated. The Weed Terminator fits all these popular gas trimmers, and it's yours now for only $19.95 with an extra set of blades free. Don't miss this opportunity. Call now.
Call toll-free 1-800-757-3535. That's 1-800-757-3535. Or send $19.95 plus shipping to Weed Terminator to Morgan Avenue, Norwalk, Connecticut. Call now.
Bring it on! The ATP Tour presents the Lipton Championships. Men's semifinals tomorrow at 7:30, live on ESPN2.
So, are you with AT&T?
No.
Oh, how's your long-distance company working out for you?
I'm not happy at all.
But what if I gave you some really good reasons to switch to AT&T, including up to 100 free AT&T minutes?
That would be wonderful.
Only AT&T customers can get AT&T True Reach Savings.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, spend $25 a month and you save 25% on every type of call on your AT&T phone bill.
It's easy.
It's free. You can call anyone, anywhere in the U.S. and you see your savings on your AT&T phone bill.
I don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure it out.
No. But you do have to be an AT&T customer. Switch now and we'll send you AT&T long-distance certificates. Good for up to 100 free AT&T minutes. You can use your free minutes to call, well, anybody. So, what are you going to do?
Switch to AT&T.
Good. Then why not give us a call right now?
You didn't ask me what I was going to do.
Okay. Who's a long-distance company for you?
It's hands down AT&T.
That's your true choice, AT&T.
Michigan coach Red Berenson was known to have one of the best backhands in the history of the NHL. Well, one of his Wolverine players will forever be known as having the best lacrosse-like shot in history of hockey as well. It's a shot that everyone's still talking about, and a shot bound to be imitated again and again. Here's Bill Pito.
Nothing called, and Michigan's still scrambling. It's a goal. Michigan finally somehow got it in the net to tie the game.
I don't believe I saw what I think I just saw.
It's almost impossible to believe the sight of it. So what are the odds that it's happened before? How about one day before?
Play goes in behind the Cleveland net. Here's Armstrong. Tries to tuck it, and he did! Oh, he laid the stick down and
ripped it off! Unbelievable goal. Unbelievable that they happen in the same weekend. Coincidence or not?
I did it on Saturday night, and I was bugging our PR guy to get it, to send it into ESPN, and all the guys were saying, get it to ESPN. And then the next night before the game, we played again on Sunday night at 6, and one of the guys came in and said somebody from Michigan did it, and I figured right away it was Mike, because I knew he went to Michigan, and we played together in the summer back home in London.
London, Ontario, that is. Practice sessions that must have contained significant time devoted to that unique goal-scoring maneuver.
I do it in practice every day, and just goofing around after practice like this. It's something to just goof around, try something new, and just keep working on it.
The technique seems so simple. Lift the puck on its edge and get it flat on the blade of the stick. Lift the stick and tuck the puck in behind the baffled goaltender. So simple, yet no NHL player has ever tried it.
Everybody can pretty much pick the puck up like that. It's not real tough to do, but I never thought of doing that in a game. No, it's never occurred to me. And after seeing it, it looks so easy. You kind of sit there and wonder why you've never tried it. But I don't think I'd try it, but I really admire the guy for doing it and pulling it off.
too hot right now to start trying it, you know, because all the media is, I think, looking for everybody to start doing it. So maybe when it dies down a little, maybe I'll start working on it and add it to my repertoire for next season.
Well, will Legg be able to do that again tonight? Problems with the ice all afternoon. Let's head out to Cincinnati. Tom Mies, Bob Morton. Bob, Tom, what do you have?
All right, Rich, we have good news from the Riverfront Coliseum in Cincinnati. No, we're not set to drop the puck yet, but we do have ice again, and the Michigan Wolverines and the Terriers at BU are out there warming up for the second semifinal. The winner of this game plays Colorado College for the national title. And, Bob, we have so much talent on the ice for these two teams. It's been tough to figure out who we might want to focus on tonight.
Well, you know, there's a lot of guys you can focus on. Boston University has four All-Americans in the team. But these teams have some guys that are going to come up, you know, that will surprise over the course of tonight's play. Like Mike Legg in that tournament game in the finals in the regional tournament, puts a puck on end and then sort of flips it into the net. You know, the guys you're surprised to look at sometimes. Marty Turco, of course, he's won a bunch of games over 2 years, 59 wins for Michigan over two seasons. Loney's been an outstanding player out of Calgary, Alberta. Big right winger at 6'1 with 20 goals this season. And Mike Legg, very consistent, 10 goals as a freshman, 14 as a sophomore, 14 this year as a junior, none bigger than the one he scored against Minnesota.
Now, BU is trying to do something, friends, that hasn't been done in over 20 years. That's repeat as Division I men's ice hockey champions. They won, of course, last year in Providence. They're going to try and win again, and they've got loads of players we can focus on, but we picked out three to look at.
Well, the ones that we're talking about tonight are the ones that just cause you trouble over the course of tournament play. When you look at LeChair, Chris O'Sullivan, he's their leading scorer in NCAA tournament play, an All-American forward, moved back to defense. Bates plays with great enthusiasm. He was on the all-tournament team last year in the NCAA tournament. And LeChance, of all the guys in this team, 40% of his total career goals have been scored in tournament play. The number two scorer in history at BU in NCAA tournament action. Bobby LeChance comes up big in these kind of games.
What kind of game are we going to have, Bob?
Well, I'll tell you, whoever plays the best defense is going to win. You know, these two teams are explosive offensively. There's no question they're the two best offensive teams in the country. BU has set an all-time record for goals scored. Michigan scores a million goals. The team that gets the best goaltending and plays the best defense in their own end is going to win. These offenses cancel each other out.
So it's been a late night with you fans in the Detroit and Boston metro areas. I think you'll be glad you hung with us. Ice problems have been solved. Michigan and Boston University, they say the puck drop will be at 9:30 Eastern time. We'll have the game live for you on ESPN2.
They're still back there.
Don't worry, love. You're riding in the world's first sport utility wagon.
I am.
That's right. This year's the all-wheel drive Subaru Outback.
That's great.
You know, it's got more cargo space than a passport.
Uh-huh.
The ground clearance of an Explorer.
Yeah, lucky.
Well, did I mention, it gets much better gas mileage than a Jeep Cherokee.
Outback, you say?
Subaru Outback. The world's first sport utility wagon.
Surgery is a step-by-step procedure.
Midas Way isn't so different. Our trained experts follow rigorous step-by-step procedures, so the job's done right. Well, they may leave a clamp in there, but only if it's necessary.
Through Saturday, all Craftsman hand tools, power tools, lawn and garden equipment on sale, and every gallon of paint on sale. But hurry, it all ends Saturday at Sears.
Good. Looks like we're going to have hockey. Looks like Michigan and Boston University will play to see who will play Colorado College in the NCAA Hockey Finals. Until then, here's another Be a Player featuring Bernie Nichols. Thanks for sticking with us. Again, puck drops at 9:30 Eastern. Enjoy.
No gas, no glory.
I go around. I have a lot of friends in the league. I talk to them. But still, when it comes time to play, I feel that I'm as intense and want to win more than anybody.
The NHLPA presents Be a Player, the hockey show. Brought to you by EA Sports. If it's in the game, it's in the game. And by Upper Deck. You don't just watch the game, you play it.
Hi there, good to see you again. Welcome to Be a Player, the hockey show. I'm your host, Paul Romanek, coming to you this week from Chicago, one of the greatest sports towns in North America, and specifically, we're in front of the United Center, home of the Chicago Blackhawks, and yes, that guy, Michael Jordan, one of the greatest in the history of the NBA. It's a hockey show, but hey, you got to show that great statue of Michael. Nonetheless, lots of hockey-related stuff coming your way over the course of the next half hour. We're going to visit with Bernie Nichols, one of the most creative offensive players in the National Hockey League. More about that coming up a little bit later on. We'll ask him about hockey and about his golf game as well. The usual stuff packed in there, too. Wayne Gretzky's great hockey moments. The great moment features Bobby Orr, a man who has had as big an impact on his sport, hockey, as that guy, Michael Jordan, has on his sport of basketball. And John Davidson, along with the hockey heroes. The hero this week, a man who has attained almost a godlike status in the province of Quebec in Canada. I'm talking about Maurice the Rocket Richard, one of the greatest ever for the Montreal Canadiens. They say you could see the fire in his eyes when he was out there competing for the Canadiens. All that stuff is coming up, so hang on. We'll start things off with the Billboard Hit Parade. Now, you might not want this on your living room rug, but hey, it's beautiful. It's a Chicago Blackhawks logo stitched right into the rug. First clue that we are indeed inside a genuine National Hockey League dressing room. Really neat rooms to walk into. I still get kind of a thrill out of coming in to talk to the players in the NHL locker rooms. This is one of the nicest ones in the league, actually. Very big, very spacious. It's in Chicago, where the Blackhawks make their home. The room usually serves two purposes. On the one hand, it's a sanctuary. It's a private place where the players come to get away, sit around, talk with one another, prepare for the game, wind down after the game, come here for practices and so on. Also, though, a very public place. It's where members of the media come in to meet the players, people like me. Thus, in a lot of the rooms, you have names over the lockers. Eric Desai, great young player, sits right here. Denny Savard, NHL legend, sits in this spot in the Chicago dressing room. Jeff Schantz, very good young hockey player, sits in this spot. And Jeff, we're going to borrow your spot for a minute. One thing I see players do quite often, not quite often, but on occasion, you come in and they'll be talking hockey, and they'll be talking hockey trivia. Sometimes a guy will pull out a book like this, the official guide and record book, and they'll test one another's knowledge of the game trivia-wise, which is exactly what we're going to do in this segment of the show. One of the best segments of the show, they're all pretty good, but we like this one. Here's what you do. You go to your computer, you log on to the NHLPA website. The address is nhlpa.com. I'm going to ask you the question. You're going to give me the answer. You have to give the answer before we give it later on in the show. If you're the first person to do that, you will receive a hockey video game courtesy of EA Sports. This is a great game. It's the one that everybody's talking about. Then we're going to take all the other correct answers given before we give you the answer later on in the show. From that lot, we will draw the name of one lucky person. That person receives an NHLPA hockey jersey with an autograph to boot. So here's the question. Get the trivia cap on. The question is, three teenagers to accumulate 100 or more points in a single NHL season. Three teenagers, 100 or more points in a single season. Good luck.
Send your answer via the internet to the NHLPA's website at www.nhlpa.com.
Rachel heard about what Mark said about Patty? Well, Bill, are you listening? Anyway, Patty ran into Rachel, who had run into Mark at a party. So, according to Bill, are you listening to me or to the game?
Five ticks left on the clock. Missiles down by one. Just a reminder, this game brought to you by Miller Lite. When you've got the great taste of an ice-cold Miller Lite, life is good. Smith inbounds, Wakeman through the paint. Tomahawk jam! Yes!
Welcome back to the show. We're still hanging out in the Chicago Blackhawks dressing room, and come on over here. This is Veterans Row in the Chicago dressing room. Brent Sutter, Jeremy Roenick, Bob Probert, Joe Murphy, and right here in this very spot, Bernie Nichols, a guy playing in his 15th season in the National Hockey League. 15 years. Time flies, as they say. I still remember Bernie in his final year of junior hockey. He played with the Kingston Canadians in the Ontario Hockey League. 152 points in his last year. Dynamic playmaker, a fun player to watch. Just weave around out there on the ice, and he's taken all those skills, rolled them over into a great run in the National Hockey League. You know what else? Bernie is a tremendous golfer. We found that out when we had a chance to spend some time with him during the offseason at his home in California. Went out to the golf course with Bernie and some of his friends, and man, it was a sight to behold. We also met Bernie's family. All in all, a splendid time was had. Enjoy our visit and your visit with number 92. First of all, just a little bit about your house. Walking in, what it really says to me is family. You know, pictures of the kids, the welcome mat with the hearts on it. I mean, the whole bit. Is it your sort of refuge from everyday life?
That's more probably my wife's side, you know. But the kids are obviously a big part of it, and she obviously tries to make it a home and family orientated, and she's done a great job.
Which lunchbox is yours? Which lunchbox?
You ever think about your kids and your wife for inspiration when you're in a tough situation in a game?
Well, I think I had a son that I lost a year ago from spinal meningitis, you know. When things get real bad sometimes, I think about him a little bit. Your kids.
Can I ask you a couple questions about the child you lost?
Sure.
How difficult was it to just go through everyday life for you when all that was going on?
Well, it was extremely difficult. It was a time where I had just been traded to New Jersey. I went to New Jersey. My wife, she came back here with the kids, and her mom and dad are from here, so she came here, and she was here 2 weeks, and my boy got spinal meningitis, and you know, you go to a new team, and you really want to go there and do well. You know, you feel you can help their team. They got you here for a reason. And I was just there 2 weeks, and he got sick, and I had to come back here. So I was traveling back and forth, and I got here. He was basically in a coma. They didn't think he would make it. That was very difficult because I was traveling back and forth, and you know, I was losing my conditioning a little bit. Trying to help the team where, you know, my mind really wasn't there. And it was the first year I ever went in the playoffs not wanting to be there. We end up losing, I think, 4-1 to Pittsburgh. but it was like we were losing games by one goal, you know, and I really felt if I was healthy and played the way I played my whole career, you know, I really think we could have made a difference.
Bernie Nichols, one-on-one with Wesley, picks up Lemieux, fires, score! Bernie Nichols!
Because of what you've been through, do you think that you cherish the simple things about the game, hacking around in practice, joking around with the guys, the camaraderie? Do you think you appreciate that a little bit more?
Well, that's something that I've always been able to do. You know, it's always been a game to me, and, you know, I think I've learned a lot since I've been traded. You know, when you get traded, it's devastating because you feel you're going to be in one place for a long time. At least I did. And, you know, this game to me has been the best game there is, and I've always loved it as a game, and it's always been fun to me, you know. And that's my approach to the game, and a lot of times I get criticized for not being serious, being a little lackadaisical out there and having too much fun, but that's the way I am. You know, I go around, I have a lot of friends in the league, I talk to them, but still when it comes time to play, I feel that I'm as intense and want to win more than anybody.
We needed Bernie. We needed a guy that was a little bit different in the locker room because I think we're a real uptight group as a whole in the dressing room. You guys worked with Bernie, you know how loose he is, and he's got a great attitude. He competes, but at the same time, he doesn't, you know, take it to heart. He does, but he doesn't. I don't know how you can explain it, but when he's out on the ice, he's all business. And even though it doesn't look like it because he's always smiling and looking around, he competes probably better than anybody I've ever seen.
What's the absolute for you in your career, the absolute top of the mountain so far? Couldn't get any higher.
Well, I'd like to say it was winning the Stanley Cup, you know. We've came close. I think last year in New Jersey we got to the semifinals and went seven games. That was obviously very exciting. You know, I think anytime you have personal goals, like I said, I scored 70 goals and I had 150 points one year. That's obviously real exciting, you know, to be able to do that.
I just want to get back to your life away from the game a little bit, out in the golf course, spending some time with you out there. How is your demeanor different out on the course playing golf as opposed to playing an NHL game? Is it different at all?
Well, it is. You know, golf is such a frustrating game. You know, you can play great one day and terrible the next day. And it's a game that, golf is my favorite game. I try to play golf every day if I could. You know, I play it during the season. I play it all summer. It's just the hockey, you know, everything just comes natural. And golf, you got to work so hard. It's so mechanical. No one can ever conquer the game of golf, so to speak.
Tell me a bit about the guys you were golfing with today.
Bob Meeks is the dad of Eric Meeks. He's a young kid. Chief, yeah. He has the twins, Eric and Aaron. Aaron, he's away in Europe playing right now. They're both pro golfers.
Jim Fox isn't bad for an old hockey guy.
Jimmy Fox, I played a lot of hockey with Jim growing up, and or when I first turned pro, and you know, Jimmy's been a good friend for a long time, and I called him to come out. And, you know, as you see, we always have fun out there.
Oh, I hit it. Count it. Boom, baby. Want to get that for me? Thank you. Oh, it's such an easy game, huh, Chief?
Puts it over to Nichols. Nichols.
What should people know about you that they wouldn't know from just reading a magazine article, seeing a TV interview, watching you play? What's important for them to know about you?
I always felt that, you know, I'd like people to think that he is a really nice guy. I always feel that I'm a quiet person at times. You know, I like to kind of get away by myself and just be alone. You know, because a lot of times people see you smiling and, you know, joking around. I always feel that when it comes time to play, I don't think there's a guy more dedicated to the game and gives it any more than me. And when I come up, you know, I usually
have a smile on my face, and I think a lot of times people misunderstand that as not really caring, you know, but I always feel that, you know, what happens on the ice, you have to leave it in the dressing room, and you got to come out and present yourself in a professional way and just move forward and look forward to the next day.
Blackhawks come out. Craven has Nichols breaking by the defense. Nichols scores. It's 5-1 Chicago.
This Be a Player profile has been brought to you by Duracell. You can't top the copper top.
There's a place in New York owned by the biggest sports stars around.
You know, I like to perform here.
And you never know when they'll show up.
Well, sure.
It's the official All-Star Cafe.
Ken Griffey Jr., 301 lifetime average.
Where the owners are always willing to help out.
Excuse me, it's 302.
So if you go, bring the right stats and the right card. Visa, because the All-Star doesn't take American Express.
301 lifetime average.
Visa, it's everywhere you want to be.
Only the Sears Auto Center is filled to capacity with these top brand tires. And through Saturday, they're all on sale. All sizes for all vehicles at guaranteed unbeatable prices. Only at our garage, the Sears Auto Center.
Want it hot? Look for the dot. The ultimate deep dish hits the spot.
Get up to three toppings on a medium, just $8.99. Any second medium, $4.99.
Now. Hot and wild, call Domino's.
Great Hockey Moments with Wayne Gretzky is brought to you by Upper Deck. You don't just watch the game, you play it.
One of the most talented defensemen ever to play the game of hockey, it seemed Bobby Orr was destined for greatness from the moment he put on a Boston Bruins uniform. In the 1970 Stanley Cup Final, that greatness was etched into the memories of hockey fans everywhere.
Good job killing that penalty. Tony had one good shot on Seaver, the backhand side.
Four across the line, going in, shot,
boom! In 1970, 22-year-old Bobby Orr became the first defenseman to win the scoring title with 120 points. But Orr was not content with individual glory. The Bruins had not won a Stanley Cup since 1941, and he was a man on a mission. Throughout the playoffs, Orr dominated opposing teams.
Orr shipped on all the way back room, shot!
In the final, despite tight checking by a game St. Louis squad, Boston had a commanding 3-0 lead.
However, the Bruins were about to let up, and Stanfield shot them into a 1-0 lead. Lately again is in goal for the Bulls.
Game 4 went into overtime, thanks to the spectacular play of Blues goalie, Glenn Hall. Then, seconds into the extra frame, Orr struck, taking a feed from Derek Sanderson and flipping it into the St. Louis net as he soared through the air. It was his only goal of the series, but his controlling presence throughout the playoffs earned him the Conn Smythe Trophy and a place in great moments in hockey. Join me next time on Be a Player for more great hockey moments. I'm Wayne Gretzky.
Let's talk exercise.
Lifting the TV remote. Does that count?
What if it were easy?
Well, I'd like to know what you call easy.
20 minutes a day, 3 days a week.
And what do we call this marvel of modern exercise?
The Nordic Rider, new from Nordic Track.
The new Nordic Rider is the smooth, easy way to get fit at a great price. Advanced push and pull dual motion lets you exercise more muscle groups, including your arms, legs, back, chest, and stomach. Burn off calories and get a better total body workout with the new Nordic Rider. Yours for only $299.95. The Nordic Rider is from Nordic Track, a recognized leader in home fitness, so your complete satisfaction is guaranteed. Try it for 30 days in your home and see the results. If you're not 100% satisfied, send it back for a refund. Call now for a free information kit about the only rider that's good enough for the Nordic Track name. The Nordic Rider. Call the number on your screen today for a free information kit.
Drivers.
in the world's fastest cars.
The NCAA Foundation supports programs that respond to the needs of student athletes. Programs include degree completion scholarships, Choices Alcohol Education Grants, Life Skills, Winning for Life, and Sports Journalism Scholarships. The NCAA Foundation, enhancing the present and future of student athletes.
This message provided by the NCAA.
It's time for John Davidson's Hockey Heroes, brought to you by Bauer and Cooper, the names wear.
He was a dominant player on one of hockey's greatest dynasties. Maurice the Rocket Richard was the pride of the Canadiens and one of the fiercest competitors the game had ever seen.
The advantage lasted only 3 minutes. Moore's backhander deflects to Maurice Richard, and there's number one of his 4 goals.
Armed with dazzling moves, a tenacious spirit, and speed that left opposing players grasping at air, the Rocket entered the league in 1942 and immediately began his assault on the record book.
The Rocket takes the pass, moves into scoring position. You're watching an old family custom.
At age 23, the Canadiens winger became the first player to score 50 goals in 50 games. Playing on the famous punch line with Toblake and Elmer Locke, Richard was a scoring machine. In the playoffs against arch rival Toronto Maple Leafs, the Rocket exploded for 5 goals in a single game. To the delight of Forum fans, Richard was voted the first star, second star, and third star of the game.
And ahead to Elmer Locke, a pass on the wing for Richard. He picks it up.
Richard led the Habs to 8 Stanley Cups, including a record stretch of 5 in a row with teammates Jean Béliveau, Boom Boom Geoffrion, and Doug Harvey. He was so beloved by the Forum faithful, his suspension caused the famous Richard riot on St. Patrick's Day, 1955. Over 18 years in the National Hockey League, Maurice Richard was named to the first or second All-Star team on 14 occasions, and scored 544 goals with 421 assists. In 1961, Maurice Richard was inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame. His 6 playoff overtime goals still stand as a record today, proving that when the game was on the line, the Rocket was there to answer the call. For Hockey Heroes, I'm John Davidson.
Week's trivia question is, what NHL
who is the Be a Player trivia is brought to you by EA Sports. If it's in the game, it's in the game.
Well, Jeopardy, isn't it?
Okay, name 3 teenagers who have scored 100 points in an NHL season.
Gretzky.
Gretzky's one.
Mario Lemieux.
No.
He didn't score 100?
No, not according to Machida.
Easy.
Well, Wayne's got it.
Wayne.
You're right on one of them. This is easy.
Mario?
Nope.
Sakic?
Nope.
100 points.
Playing right now?
You know what? All 3 of them are still playing.
Gretzky?
So here's one.
Mario Lemieux?
Messier?
Jimmy Carson? Is that right?
Yeah, that's one of them.
Wow, that's
okay.
Pretty good.
Wow.
Luke
Robitaille?
Yeah. No. He tuned us for about 3 points last night.
Brett Hull?
No.
Chorus?
No.
You got 3 points.
How much wood would a wood
chip? Dale Hart? Okay. Howardchuk?
Dale Howardchuk.
Dale Howardchuk. Dale Howardchuk.
Yeah?
No. Oh, Gretzky, I started out the good easy effort, one.
Good effort. The correct answer is Wayne Gretzky, Dale Howardchuk, and Jimmy Carson.
Drops it back, Howardchuk cruising with quick shot, he scores!
Rebound to Carson, shooting, he scores! Jimmy Carson!
This is for my grandfather, who always said I'd make the family proud. For my mom, who never let me out the door without my homework. For my dad, who worked the night shift to make our lives better.
Hurry up. It's mine.
For myself. For my future.
Here at Firestone, we know what it takes to get your attention.
One heck of a tire!
A Firestone tire with all the warranty you'd ever want, plus...
One heck of a price!
You got it, an unbelievable price. $4 for $99 on genuine Firestones. The winningest tire name ever at Indy. Firestone quality at an affordable price. Got your attention, huh? Hurry in now to your local Firestone retailer.
For cars that can benefit from higher octane...
Frank, we're late.
Texaco Clean System 3 Power Plus and Power Premium are formulated to clean your engine's intake valves, fuel injectors, and combustion chambers while you're driving. For smooth starts and sure acceleration, just give us 5 tanks, and we think you'll see a difference. A word of advice, though. Maybe you'd better leave the windows rolled up.
That is our show. It's been kind of fun hanging out in the Chicago Blackhawks dressing room. Hope you've enjoyed the tour. We're out of time. Be sure to join us next time on Be a Player, the hockey show. We're going to catch up with Detroit Red Wings defenseman Paul Coffey, the highest scoring defenseman in the history of professional hockey. You won't want to miss that. You won't want to miss this either. Before we go, time to sneak in a special treat for you. We're going to take you on a walk that very few people get to make. The select few would be guys who play for the Chicago Blackhawks. This is the route the players take out underneath the stands to get out there at the start of a game. Here's how they go. They're going to come up through these double gray doors right here. You walk along, watch your step there. You come along into this corridor. Now, when you get here, you can start to hear it. The players will tell you. 20,000 people packed into this building. It's a sound like no other. The rumble of the Chicago United Center. The players walk along here. You can hear the organ. You can hear the PA announcer. Ladies and gentlemen, the Chicago Blackhawks out through here and out into the building. It's full of people. The organ music is going. There's a big ovation. The Hawks take to the ice. That would be a huge thrill, and it's a thrill only a select few get a chance to experience. Hope you enjoyed the show. I'm Paul Romanek. We'll catch you next time.
Be a Player, the hockey show, has been brought to you by EA Sports. If it's in the game, it's in the game. And by Upper Deck. You don't just watch the game, you play it. We'll be right back.